We read two scriptures opening this morning there in 2 Timothy 4, Paul's last writing. We read a scripture there in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18, as Paul's writing to the church there at Corinth. And then we're going to look at the one who was writing those scriptures. We're going to look at that individual that did exactly what he told others to do. Amen. He told others to preach the cross. He told others to preach the word. Amen. And now we're going to see him doing what he was telling others to do. What are we missing today? Amen. We're missing the preaching of the Word of God. I'm not just talking about the pulpits of America. I'm talking about our homes and our workplaces. I'm talking about preaching everywhere we go. And if you have your Bibles in Acts, did I tell you chapter number 17? Acts 17 we're going to be looking at this morning. While you're turning, I'll just give you just a little brief here in verse of 17. We see the founding of the church as it was kind of getting started in Thessalonica there in chapter or verses 1 through 4, and then we see the Jewish opposition there at Thessalonica, verses 5 through 9. Jason, this is where we find our name in the Bible, by the way. Amen. Now, Jason is a biblical name. Most people don't even know Jason was in the Bible. You say, Jason's in the Bible? No, Jason wasn't in the Bible. I say, yeah, it was. Anyway, so, but nonetheless. So we see the Jewish opposition. I mean, there's always opposition when you try to start or do anything for God. And so don't be amazed. It just didn't work out. Well, guess what? Amen. Don't quit trying. Keep going forth. But the church of Thessalonica there, and you can read the Thessalonians, the books there, 1st and 2nd Thessalonians as well. But anyway, 5 through 9, we see that opposition there. And then we see Paul and Silas were at Berea there in verse number 10. It says, and the brethren immediately sent away Paul and Silas by night unto Berea, who coming thither went into the synagogues of the Jews. So we see them working there in Berea. But then in verse number 15 is where I really want to start off with. They had sent Paul to Athens, okay? Now these were Paul and Silas. They were preaching the gospel and they were trying to start churches. And you know, our church is going to be 3 years old this June as we started having our first service here. And you know, it's the same as them. I mean, they were planting churches and they were getting the Word of God and preaching the Word of God. And this is much newer at this time. This is around 53 AD. But I want to say in verse 15, so they sent Paul, long story short here, and we're going to take up reading here in verse 15. We're going to kind of go through these scriptures here. It says, And they that conducted Paul brought him into Athens, and receiving a commandment unto Silas and Timotheus for to come to him with all speed, they departed. So what happened here, what this verse is saying, Paul got to Athens, and as soon as Paul got there, he sent word back. He said, I want you to tell Silas and Timotheus, or Timothy, to hurry up and get here. Now, where they just left from was about 200 miles distance, amen? They didn't have cell phones. It was a couple years later. They didn't have the World Wide Web. I mean, they couldn't email somebody. And so it took a while to get that message for these guys that took Paul there to get back there to tell them, and then for them to actually take another 200 miles back to Paul. So it took some time here for Timothy and Silas to get back to Paul. So Paul's by himself here, okay? In life, you may feel by yourself, but I want to say God will work even if you're by yourself. I mean, if your family turns your back on you, serve God and serve Him faithfully. If everything falls apart, serve God. And that's what Paul did throughout his ministry. Verse number 16. I'm trying to lay some groundwork here. Verse number 16. Now while Paul waited for them at Athens, okay, here he's waiting, and he's waiting a long time, his spirit was stirred in him when he saw the city wholly given to idolatry. I mean, could you imagine? You ever went to a mall somewhere and your wife was shopping, and you said, oh, there's a bench. I think I'll sit down there. And you sit down there and you just begin to watch people. How many of us men have ever done that?
Yes, sir.
Amen. Amen. Every one of us. Amen. Right. But have you ever watched people? And doesn't it trouble you to see the sin in their life? You say, how can you judge sin? I mean, what's on the inside is going to come on the outside. I'm not being mean when I say that. I'm not being judgmental. I'm just being obvious and real. Okay, Paul was stirred because of what he saw. The Bible says, now he waited for them at Athens, and his spirit was stirred in him when he saw the city wholly given to idolatry. The greatest idol in America today is our own individual selves. Amen. That's the greatest idol that we bow down and worship. So we don't have idols here. There's more idols than just ourselves. There's many idols in religion, even in here in America. But I want to say, he was moved. He was stirred within himself. And I believe without a doubt, us that are saved by the grace of God, we need to be stirred because of sin today. Yeah. Amen. Today, sin doesn't move us like it should. You say, why should sin move you? Because it ought to move us to do something righteous and holy. And that's what Paul's getting ready to do. Paul wasn't just one that said, hey, you need to preach the word, be instant in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all long suffering. He wasn't one that just said it, but he did it with the word of God. And then verse number, because of his waiting, his watching, and his stirring within himself. Verse number 17, we begin to see the desire in Paul's heart for the preaching of the word of God. Paul had desire to preach before here, but I want to say the waiting and the watching and the stirring caused him great desire, as verse number 17 says. Therefore, disputed he in the synagogue with the Jews. This word disputed, the same Greek word comes from the word reason. There was questioning and answers, and they would bring up questions and he would answer them. And that's the situation here. It wasn't rioting, amen. I don't want you to get the wrong picture here. But he was in the synagogue with the Jews and with the devout persons and in the market daily with them that met him. What did Paul go do? I mean, Paul just left. He said, hey, I'm going to the synagogues. I'm going to the marketplaces. I'm going to everywhere I can go, and I'm going to tell about Jesus Christ. I'm going to give them the answer for the problems of their life. You know what we have done, what our culture has done? I'm just trying to break the iceberg here. I'm trying to break the eggshells that we're living in. Our culture is saying, hey, we just preach Jesus at church, and we don't need to preach Jesus outside the walls. So wrong are we, amen. We're dead wrong, amen. Here, he went to the synagogues with the Jews and with the devout persons. He didn't care if they was a president. He didn't care if they was a, I'm just using that as an example. He didn't care who it was. He was preaching and reasoning with him about who Christ was. The desire to preach was in Paul's heart. The desire to preach was in Paul's life. And again, we could take time, we don't have it this morning, but I want to say this, we could take time and look at Paul. Paul didn't always have that desire. At one time, Paul was lost and he was going to hell because he did not know the Lord Jesus Christ. What turned him around? I mean, he was a persecutor of Christians. We could go find in the Word of God that said, Paul, they went and they knocked on the doors and they were searching out for Christians in those cities of Jerusalem and they were locking them up in prison. But here now, an individual, he's not looking for Christians the same way, but he's looking for people to become Christians, amen. And he's preaching the Word of God, reasoning with everybody that he could. Can you imagine? He was going to all the doors at one time trying to persecute them, but now he's going to all the people that he can find now trying to tell them about Christ. The desire for preaching was in Paul's heart. I believe without a doubt, the desire to preach the word ought to be in every one of our hearts. You say, well, I'm not called to preach. I beg your pardon. You're called to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. You may not be called the pastor. You may not be called an evangelist. But you are called to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. I want you to notice some things. Here, verse number 18. I said, then certain philosophers of the Epicureans and of the Stoics encountered him. These Epicureans, they were lustful people. That just, I don't want to go down that road, but I want to say very, very lustful people. And that is the day and age that we live in. Amen. I don't have regular TV no more, but the commercials, you don't have, anytime a commercial series comes on, there's lust in those things. Amen. And we're feeding it and cramming it down our children's throats. And so I'm going to say we're living in just the same day and time that Paul was facing here in this day and time. And it says, and of the Stoics, if you get a picture here, let me paint a picture for you of a heavy rock band and a drug and the drug industry, the druggies of the world. They live with a sense of death all about them, death metal. And I mean, that's the sense of those Stoics, amen. They had a great curiosity of the things of death. But these are some of the people that Paul was preaching to here at this time. But notice what they said. And some said, "What will this babbler say?" Some, "He seemeth to be a setter forth of strange gods, because he preached unto them Jesus and the resurrection." You say, "Well, I don't really know what to talk about, people." You talk about Jesus, amen. And you talk about the resurrection of what happened there 3 days after Calvary, and you tell them about what Christ has done for you. But I want to say, this is what he was doing. He was preaching to these individual people. And again, some of them are saying, "Oh, he's just a babbler." I know that's what some of you say every Sunday morning. But anyway, I'm just kidding. But people was going to say things. Let it go off your back, amen. Don't pay any attention to that. But there was some that said, "Hey, he seems to be a setter forth of strange gods, because he preached unto them Jesus and the resurrection." Verse 19. "And they took him and brought him into Areopagus." This was a place, it used to be a great high court with great power, but this place at this time literally became just a place of disputings, and they would bring that forth and to hear what one has to say. And so it wasn't such a great high powered court at this time. And it says, "Saying, may we know what this new doctrine whereof thou speakest is." And so they had a desire to say, at least some of them did, say, "What are you talking about?" They had a desire to say, "I don't really understand this." And these people wasn't really concerned about their souls at this time. They were just wanting to learn something new. Okay? That's really where they were at. They wasn't, there was no really conviction. They were just, "Hey, here's something new we never heard before. Let's listen to it." Many of you, when you're searching the web, you'll come across it, "Oh, I just want to listen to it." I want you to say, be careful, amen, what you listen to. Now, you can listen to anything, but you better line up this Word of God, amen. This ought to be the first and foremost thing in your life. And so, let's go on here, verse number 19. "So they took him, and they got there," verse 20, "for thou bringest certain strange things to our ears. We would know, therefore, what these things mean." And so, they had a curiosity about them. I want to tell you, if you would share the simple, pure gospel to some people, it's going to be strange to their ears. You don't have to go to India or Africa. You don't have to go to Asia. You don't have to go. You can go right here in Harlan County, Phelps County. You can go to Franklin. This is Franklin County, right? Yeah. And Furnace County. You can go, all around us, and you just give them the simple gospel. They'll say, "No, they got to have something more to that. I mean, they have to add to that." And they're missing the gospel. And so we need to be aware of that in our day and time as well. And so they was wanting to hear. Verse 21, "For all the Athenians and strangers which were there spent their time in nothing else but either to tell or to hear something new." Isn't that the day and age we live in? I'm still laying the groundwork to get started here. But everybody's wanting something new. I mean, why does everybody run to the new cell phones, you know? Oh, it's new! Why does everybody want the new car? Why don't people, you know, just satisfy with what they got? Amen. I'm just saying, this day and age we live in is the same people. People don't change. Amen. And here we go. Here we're going on. Verse number 22. We talked about the desire for the preaching in Paul's heart. Now we're going to see the discerning or discernment for Paul's preaching. Anytime you preach, we need to have a discernment of who we're preaching to. Amen. If I knew I was in the village of up in northern Ghana, and I knew where I was at, majority of those people, a lot of them are lost and never heard the gospel. And I would be preaching a message of salvation here this morning. And salvation ought to be entwined in every message. Amen. We've talked about the cross. We've talked about the gospel this morning. And at every service, somebody here could be lost and not be born again. And I need to be aware of that. But Paul here, he understands where he's at. He understands verse 16, what stirred him and what moved him to preach what he was preaching. So he had discernment in his message as he was preaching. He's seen the devotion of the people. I want you to notice there in verse number 22, when Paul says, "Then Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, Ye men of Athens, I perceive that in all these things you're too superstitious." You see that? I perceive his discernment. You're too superstitious. Now, what's he really mean here, these words? And I don't want you to throw it off track for the days, but they were just too religious. They were so religious, they were worshiping idols. Yeah. Amen? Just because you're religious doesn't mean you're saved. Just because you're religious doesn't mean you know Jesus Christ. Just because you're religious doesn't mean you're going to heaven one day. He's saying you're too religious. What stirred him was because the whole city was given to idolatry. I mean, they were worshiping. They were devoted. He saw their devotion, but their devotion wasn't worshiping the true and living God. And so discerning that, he also discerned something else. He saw, and don't lose track here, and don't fault me for using this word, but he saw the dumbness of the people. And you see, the Bible uses the word ignorant a lot, which is just not knowing or being dumb to something. I'm pretty ignorant of a lot of things. I couldn't even get their VCR to work the other day, you know. And I thought, where's Elijah? You know. And so I'm ignorant. I'm dumb about things. And we ought to be okay with that. Amen. It's just being real. But Paul recognized, even though they were devout in their worshiping of these idols, they were still yet dumb. Notice verse 23. For as I passed by and beheld your devotions, I found an altar with this inscription: to the unknown God, whom therefore ye ignorantly worship, him declare unto you. He's saying, hey, I perceive something. I perceive you're a devout people and you're worshiping these idols. But at the same time, I perceive and I understand that you're just ignorant of the one that you ought to be worshiping, this unknown God. And so Paul, in his desire of preaching, he's going to begin to preach Christ, and he's going to preach the deity in his preaching. If we're going to preach about God, we ought to preach about who he is. Amen. And of this book and out of the Bible. And then in verse number 24, he began to preach on the power of God. Verse 24, God that made the world and all things therein. He began to preach on the power of God. And we see that. I want to say that's one of the major faults of our churches today and pastors today and of our Christian homes today. We allow Discovery Channel and the History Channel and every other cultic channel and garbage to enter our homes and say this is a billion years old. This is a million years old. What does the Bible say? Amen. We ought to read the Word of God. We ought to be a student and a study of the Word of God. We ought to know that this world that we live in is around 6,000 years old. I want to say when God made all the rocks and the hills that first day, they might have looked a million years old, but it was one day old. Amen. And God created this world. We didn't come by evolution. We didn't come by some big bang of some thing that nothing knew what was going to happen and something came out of nothing. Amen. I want to say God spoke and the world was created. Amen. We can read account of that and how after each kind, every animal was created and there produced after its own kind, amen. Mankind never came from a monkey. We'll get into that some more later. But he was preaching on the power of God, how that God made the world. Amen. He said, people say, I don't want to hear that. I mean, I'm sorry, that's the truth, amen. And Paul was preaching, and if Paul preached it, and he told Timothy to preach the word, and he said, the preaching of the cross is foolish to them, but I want to say for us that are saved is the power of God. Amen. Our young people, you need to hear. I don't care what Discovery Channel says. I don't care what plaque you read at some museum. I want to say the word of God will stand when this world's on fire. Yep. Amen. God created the world. And Paul was telling them that there in verse number 24. God that made the world and all things therein. He preached on the power of God. It was God's power that created this world. But he also preached on the position of God. I'm thankful for that as well. When he said, the Lord of heaven and earth. There in verse 24. God that made the world and all the things therein, seeing that he is Lord of heaven and earth. He was letting them know that this same God that created the world, he is the Lord God of heaven and earth. There is none above him. There is none equal with him. He is God of glory, and there's none other but him. And he made that clear and plain. While this world tries today, well, we're all going after the same God. You know, the Muslims, they just worship the same God we do. No, they do not. Amen. They worship a false God by the name of Allah. Amen. Which is not God the Creator. Amen. The Jehovah God. And I want to say we need to recognize that this God is the Creator God. Amen. And has the only way of salvation through his darling Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shed his precious blood for our sins. Amen. He shared the power of God and the position of God. Don't you ever put yourself in the position of God in your life. Amen. You say, well, I don't do that. Don't let your wife become who you live for. Don't let your husband become who you live for. Don't let your children become who you live for. They are entrusted to you, just like we was teaching this morning. You are to be a steward of what God has entrusted you as a wife or a husband or children. But I want to say God is still God of heaven and earth, and you ought to recognize that and serve him in your life. Here in verse number 24 also, where he begins to preach the person of God. Notice this, verse 24 and 25, where he says, seeing that he's heaven and earth, the end of verse 24, dwelleth not in temples made with hands, neither is he worshipped with men's hands, as though it's needed anything. He's saying to these, as he's preaching here, also in verse number 29, if you'll look in that, it says, for as much then as we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the Godhead is likened to gold or silver or stone graven by art and man's devices. He's making it very plain. Now, what moved him in verse 16 when he saw the whole city wholly given to idolatry? He saw all these idols, and he just point blank said, hey, God, that unknown God that you had written on there, that inscription, I'm making him known to you. He is not made with hands, and nor is he fed with men's hands. Amen. He's nothing that's that you can tangibly go and think that you can create or do something for. You say, well, that doesn't really go on today. It does. Amen. I'm still moved when I think about just a few years back, going back to India, and I was riding there with Brother Obed, and looking out the window, and then seeing that woman, that poor woman, that breaking that coconut and pouring that coconut juice on the base of that big old tree. What was she doing? She was worshiping that tree as an idol. I mean, she needs the gospel. She needs to know that Jesus Christ is the creator of that tree, and that tree can't do anything for her. But there's millions of people around the world that are worshiping. When God and the position of God, He's Lord of heaven and earth, the person of God, He is not made with hands. Yeah. He's eternal from ever past, ever present, ever future. There is no beginning and no end with God. What else did He preach to him? He preached the primacy of God, where we get the word preeminent, the biblical word preeminent of God. There. In verse number 25, it says, the end of that verse, He giveth to all life and breath and all things. I mean, God deserves preeminence. There is no life given except it be given of God. Amen. Nothing that you ever are obtained unless God says, okay, I'll let you have it in His sovereignness. And he's preaching on that preeminence. Colossians chapter 1 is a great chapter. You don't have to turn there, but you can read later. It says he deserves all preeminence. Amen. Because there's none other like him. He created all things seen and not seen. And he preached about the preeminence of God. Do we give God preeminence in our life? Now he's preaching to them about the preeminence of God. These lost people here at Athens, he's preaching to them and he's trying to tell them about Jesus Christ. But we are supposed to be Christians, have already believed upon Christ, already been born again. Do we give him preeminence in our life? Or are we still worshiping the idol of ourselves? Are we worshiping the idol of something else? These are questions that we ought to answer our individual selves and make right with God. Let's go on here. I also see that he preached the plan of God to these people in verse number 26. And he hath made one blood of all nations of men. I'll stop right there. The plan of God. He made one nation. He made all nations of one blood.
Yeah.
You know what that means? It means God, going back to that creation, he created us all. But he had a plan for it. Amen. God didn't create man just to, I don't know what, I don't got nothing to do, I'm bored, so I'll make man, and one day, somebody will come along and I'll laugh at their jokes or something. No. God was wanting to display His grace and His mercy, and God, before He created us, listen to me, He knew that you would be a sinner, and you would choose to be that. But He wanted to display His grace and mercy to you and His love and compassion. He wants to fellowship with you. And here the plan of God, the first was in creation of man of one blood. And the plan of God, the second, I want you to notice there, the habitation of man. Verse 26, it says, for to dwell on all the face of the earth. I don't mean to bust no bubbles here. But when all the people are looking for a place to dwell in outer space, they're wasting their time. Okay? Yep. They're wasting money. Okay. Now, you can explore all you want. I love to learn new things. But if they're looking for habitation, I mean, on another place, they're looking for another, they're looking down the wrong corridor. Because
sure.
God gave us this earth to dwell on, amen. And that's another message. But anyway, so he created man. And we see the habitation of man that he preached about. But we also see the subordination of man. Notice here, verse 26, and hath determined the times before appointed. God had already determined times and things that was going to take place. You know, Jesus Christ just didn't die on a cross on just any certain day.
That's right.
He died on a predetermined time by the plan of the Heavenly Father.
Sure.
Did you know that one day when you draw your last breath, it won't just be on a time just on certain, you know, just coincidence or, oh man, they died in a car wreck. They died way before their time. No. What does it say there in verse 26? It says, and hath determined the times before appointed. Amen. What does Hebrews 9:27 tells us? For it's appointed unto a man wants to die.
Yeah.
I mean, we all have an appointment time. Paul was preaching to them about the appointment times of God. What's he preaching about? He's preaching about the subordination of men, that we don't determine everything in our life. God is sovereign. God is the one who has things in order, and we need to recognize Him. We look too much at ourselves and, well, what am I going to do today? What does God want you to do today? Amen. And then fourth, on the plan of God, he also mentions the limitations of man. Notice verse 26 again. And the bounds of their habitation. Their habitation. What are you talking about, the bounds of their habitation? God has boundaries in our lives. Amen. God had boundaries for man. But I'm going to say on the spiritual aspect, make an application to our lives. There's boundaries you should not go over. And when you go over, it's called sin. God is holy. And he said, this is right. This is holy. And when you do outside of those bounds, it's sin. And so we need to see the limitation of man. I can't get to heaven. I couldn't get to heaven on my own. Because I went over those bounds. You couldn't get to heaven on your own good works because you went over the bounds. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Everyone. And so God has set the bounds of mankind. Let's go on here and look at a few more things that Paul was preaching about. He was preaching also in verse number 27 about the pursuit of God. Notice this. Paul says that they should seek the Lord. Amen. It reminds me of Isaiah 55, verse number 6, where it says, seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. Amen. He was telling us, seek the Lord. What should we be encouraging people to do? Amen. Seek the Lord. If I ask you this morning, this past week, have you sought the Lord specifically over anything this week in prayer? Have you specifically sought Him and seeking, Lord, I need You for this. Would You answer this prayer? Would it be according to Your will? I pray it, Lord. Would it be done? Was you seeking the Lord? The greatest seeking of the Lord for any individual would be somebody that was lost and needed the grace of God for salvation, that they began to seek the Lord and say, Lord, would You search me? Would You try me? Would You open my eyes that I may see the need of Christ? But I want to say for us that are saved, we need to seek the Lord as well. And here he's preaching on the pursuit of God. Verse 27, he's also preaching here on the presence of God to these individuals. That they should seek the Lord, if haply they might feel after Him and find Him, though He be not far from every one of us. That goes right along with that special, the song that was sung earlier today. I want to say the presence of God is right near. Amen. We don't have to go halfway across the world to find God. All we have to do is be honest with Him and trust Him and believe Him by faith. And He's right there, Paul's preaching to them. These are lost individuals. He said, He's not far from me, but you can seek Him, but He's not far. And He can be found. The gospel is the greatest news in the world. And if we'll share it and tell people, seek the Lord, He can be found. He's not far from you if you just believe Him. He also talked and preached. He preached to them the presence of God there in verse 27. He also, as we're going to read a few verses, but he preached the patience of God in verse 30. Let's read verse 29 again. For as much then as we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the Godhead is likened to gold, silver, or stone, or graven by art of man's device. Verse 30, in the times of this ignorance God winked at, but now commendeth all men everywhere to repent. Here is the patience of God. The patience of God, God's great grace that He has for us.
Amen.
God's great grace. Why did God's... Brother Dibbin, I don't think mine's me picking on him. Or I'm not really picking, I'm just talking about him. But why did God allow him to live to be 57? Is that what I can't remember. And then find Christ? Why couldn't he took him out 50 years and he ain't found me yet? I think I'll just let him die lost and go to hell. It's the grace of God. But God reminds us that grace will not always strive with man in Genesis 6:3. God's grace will be expired from what he has offered you if you so push it aside. And 2 Corinthians 6:2 reminds us, now is the time to repent. Amen. Just like it says in that verse. I want you to notice he was preaching on the precept of God. That word precept means the rule of God, the command of God. Here in verse number 30 as well, where it says, but now commandeth, that's the precept of God, the command of God, all men everywhere to repent. What's he saying here? He's speaking about a universal repentance. That means no matter where you go, that all men ought to repent. They ought to have a change of mind about what they were doing. I mean, these people ought to repent. I was worshiping idols. I was worshiping false gods. I was worshiping something that will never be a help to me ever in my life. But now I've heard the true gospel of Jesus Christ, one that died for my sins and rose again. And if I believe Him and trust Him that He died for me, He would give me eternal life.
Yeah.
That's universal repentance. No matter where you go in the world, everybody ought to do what Paul was preaching to these people in Athens. Everybody. The poor. Amen. The rich. The intelligent. The not so intelligent. Amen. Like me. I'm thankful. Amen. You can be saved. I'm a testimony of that. I mean, anybody can be saved. I don't care what sin you're involved in, even right now in your life.
That's right.
I don't care what you've done in your past. Well, God won't love me. God loves you. He knew what you was going to do. And Christ died for us while we were yet sinners.
Yeah.
The Bible says. Universal repentance everywhere. Amen. We all should repent. And then verse 31, I want you to notice the punishment of God. Paul was preaching to them. It says, because he hath appointed a day. Well, doesn't that remind you of that appointment day? The Bible tells us over and over again, and we just think, oh, I can live the way I want to. It doesn't matter. Because he hath appointed a day in the which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he hath ordained, whereof he hath given assurance unto all men in that he hath raised him from the dead. What was he saying here in this verse? In the punishment of God as he's preaching, he was speaking about the predicted day of judgment. We've preached on that several times here. You say, why would you mention it again? Because I love you and I don't want you to die lost without Christ. I don't want your family members to die lost without Christ. I don't want their co-workers to die lost without Christ. I want you to be encouraged that you can go preach just like Paul did and share the same gospel that Paul shared to others. Not only the predicted day that he preached on, but he preached on the people for judgment when it says the world there. My preaching won't do it justice, but I can't imagine my children dying lost and standing there at the great white throne judgment, looking at my children before they're cast into the lake of fire. What about your parents or your siblings? That person that's your dearest friend. I'm saying this is important, that we preach the Word.
Yes.
And we get it out of these four walls. The preacher needs to get the preaching outside these four walls. You need to preach. We all, if we're saved by the grace of God, we need to be sharing. Notice the principle in judgment in that verse 31. He says, in righteousness. He's not going to judge anything unrighteous. Nobody's going to suffer when they shouldn't suffer. Here in America, Brother Danny used to work at the prison. You probably met one, maybe two, that said, "Hey, I didn't do it. I was 90% of them. I was being sarcastic when I said one or two." But there are, in reality, there have been some cases in court that people were falsely accused. I'm thankful for DNA testing and those things. It's helped eradicate some of that. But our court systems are not perfect. But I want to tell you right now, God. And His justice is 100% just and righteous in His judgments. If you suffer in hell's fire, in the lake of fire that burns forever and ever, It won't be because God didn't love you and try to get the gospel to you. It'll be because you rebelled against Him in searching and seeking Him while He may be found. I want to say this. He did preach on the principle of judgment and righteousness, and coming to a close here, the person doing the judging, you need to know, as he clarifies that in verse 31. He's speaking of Jesus Christ there. You should be able to see that pretty clearly. But there's other verses that tell us that. Romans chapter 2, verse 16 tells us that. John chapter 5, verse 22 says, "For the Father judgeth no man, but hath committed all judgment unto His Son." The one who died for your sins will be the one that will do the judging. Man, He loves you. Yeah. He doesn't want to have to say, "Depart from me." He wants to say with open arms, "Would you come unto me? Amen. Would you trust me? Would you believe upon me?" And then I want you to notice in the closing of this, as Paul preached, verse number 32, "And when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked." Oh, maybe Paul should just quit. No. Some's going to mock, but notice. "And others said, 'We will hear thee again of this matter.'" Some of them said, "I'll hear you later. I'll come back next Sunday. I'll come back Sunday night. I'll come back another time and hear the Word of God." Notice this. "So Paul departed from among them, howbeit." I love verse 34.
Yes, sir.
I mean, he preached and preached and preached. "Howbeit, certain men clave unto him." I mean, these were individuals. Nathan, would you stand up? Amen. That's nothing like real brotherly love. Samuel, would you stand up too? Amen. Amen.
Yeah.
I don't think I've ever given you two a demonstration by yourself. All right, Samuel, can you clave unto Nathan? Do you know what that means? Can you just hold on to him and not let him go? I mean, you just hold on to him. I mean, here is, you're getting ready to go. Okay, but you're going to clave unto him. Hurry, get him. I mean, could you imagine? That's the picture. "Don't go, Paul. Don't go. Tell me more. Preach more about Jesus to me." They clave unto him. Amen. You know, most of the time it's like, "Wait a minute, let me check. Wait a minute, Paul. It's past 12 o'clock. You can't preach past 12 o'clock. I know it's in the Bible somewhere. No preacher can preach past 12 o'clock. I mean, that's one of the 10th commandments, right? I mean, that's the only commandment most Christians in our day know. Preacher, don't pass 12 o'clock. I told our people Wednesday night, I said, somebody I heard this week said, the preacher, he should only preach about 15, 20 minutes, and then he loses everybody. He should just quit at 15, 20 minutes. I'm like, she never, that person never been here. But I'll say, if you got a hunger for the Word of God,
yes,
see, some of them just wanted that 15, 20 minutes, and they left, they departed, amen. They didn't want to hear it. And others said, "I'll come hear you later. I got beans burning on the stove." And then there was some other people, howbeit, amen, some of them claved unto him and said, "Preach, Paul, tell me more about Christ."
Amen.
And why did they do that? "Howbeit certain men claved unto him and believed," amen. They believed on Jesus. They trusted Christ. They believed. You can quit claving now. Amen. Amen. "Among the which was Dionysus." Now, I had that planned down. I studied that, how to say that. So just forget. I'm going to quit. Amen. But that individual and the why did I do these scribbling things and remember how to say this word? It don't matter. But anyway, these people and a woman named Demarius and others with them. Say, man, Paul, he was stirred because God moved him to preach, and he preached about who God was, and people heard and believed. Why don't people believe today? Because we're not preaching the Word of God. See, I mean, I know you hear it some here, but most people never hear it at all. If you're here today and you know not Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you don't have the assurance based on the Word of God and the Spirit of God that go hand in hand. Amen. If you don't have assurance, why don't you seek Him while He may be found? If you're here today, at least seek Him. You can't save yourself, but you can seek the Lord, amen, that He would have mercy and give you grace and open your eyes that you could trust Him. If you're here and you know you're saved, and you know that if you drop dead with a heart attack right now, or a plane crashes into this building right now, you know that you open your eyes at Jesus' feet. Amen. If you know that, I want you to be moved and stirred like Paul over somebody. You say, well, I don't know what city to start with. Start with one person. Amen. as we stand to our feet and as the pianist comes and plays softly on the piano for this time of invitation, I want you to be honest with God. What moves you? What would move you today? It ought to be the souls of mankind. Paul didn't have a nice car to be moved by a car. Paul didn't have a nice home to be moved by a home. Paul didn't have the luxuries of life that moved him. But what moved him was souls that were dying lost there in Athens, and he preached and he told them about Jesus. What I believe we have backwards, we have the material things that move us in life, but what ought to move us is souls that never die. Would you come today? Someone has responded. What about you? There's people dying lost all around us. I mean, within rock-throwing distance of the church. I mean, rock-throwing distance of your house. Rock-throwing distance. I mean, just speaking distance at your workplace. What about you today? People that are dying lost. God has commissioned the local New Testament church to go and to preach the gospel to whosoever will. Christian, I'm going to say something hard. If you're not moved, then why not at least seek Him to be moved? If God hasn't stirred you to give a gospel tract lately, if God hasn't stirred you to tell somebody about Jesus Christ and give the gospel about Jesus dying and resurrecting and coming again, and anybody, whosoever could be saved if they trust Him, if you've not done that lately, why not at least pray and say, Lord, would You move me? Would You stir me like Paul? Because I'll tell you this, if we're not stirred, we're not going to do anything. If there be one here today lost, why not come and trust Christ today? If He's opened your eyes and you realize I need to believe upon Christ and Him alone, why not come? The Bible says today is a day of salvation. You'll never regret trusting Christ. You'll never regret believing upon Him. I can't save you, the church can't save you, but Jesus Christ can save you if you believe upon Him by faith. While some are praying and others need to be praying, I wonder today, what will you allow God to do in your life? Will you leave this place saying, well, yeah, that was a message Paul preached, but this message is for all of us, every one of us. God doesn't want your neighbor to die lost. And God doesn't want you to die lost if you're here today. I beg you. Boy, Paul, he didn't care what they said about him. And I really don't care on the spiritual side what you say about me. But I want to say I love you enough to tell you the truth that Jesus Christ is the only way. Not man's religion, but faith in the finished work of the cross of Christ. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, I pray, Lord, this morning that You'd take this Scripture here in Acts, the Scripture there in 2 Timothy, the Scripture in 1 Corinthians. Preach the Word. Father, help me to be so conscious. Help me to be clear in the Gospel. And Father, tomorrow at work or tomorrow at the gas station, tomorrow wherever I need to go, oh God, help me to be conscious to get that track or that Gospel message to somebody. Father, help me not keep it within my body, my temple, but help me not keep it within these four walls of this church. But God, I pray You'd move this church to be a gospel-preaching witness to a lost and dying world. And Father, we love You because You first loved us. There is no good within us apart from the goodness that You have placed in our hearts. Father, we thank You, Lord, for Your love. Thank You for the gospel message. Lord, I thank You for these precious people here today. Lord, I pray, Lord, that You would stir in their hearts. Lord, when they drive by a so-called church building and they're worshiping idols there, would it move us, Lord, to witness to those individuals? God, would it move us? Father, I pray, Lord, that You'd do that. What only You can do. And we ask that in Jesus' most precious name, amen. Amen.